Hello and welcome to the big picture. It's crisis time again for the UPA government as one of its key and biggest ally DMK has pulled out its support. Though the numbers are still in favor of the Congress-led UPA, what with both the Samajwadi Party and Bahujan Samaj Party still on its side, it's still certainly a cause for concern. The Congress, which has been leading the coalition government for the last 9 years, has periodically during this period found itself at the center of criticism from its allies. Though every time it has managed to overcome the problems, the exit of Trinamool Congress last year and now the DMK does not augur well for the party with elections just a year away. It's no secret that its other ally, NCP, has also periodically expressed its displeasure on certain issues. With coalition in a reality in this country for some time to come, how will the Congress be able to keep its partners intact? What are these dilemmas in the UPA which creates this periodic uncertainty? Will the UPA be able to overcome the present crisis and survive its full term? We will discuss all this today with Nilotpal Basu, CPIM Central Committee member and former MP, and Venkitesh Ramakrishnan, Associate Editor, Frontline Magazine. Welcome to all of you. Venkitesh, this is a crisis, it's a periodic crisis, but this time what the way the DMK has pulled out, you know, normally we would have had a longer period of drama and, you know, all those things, but this was quite unexpected. You know, morning they decided, evening they went and withdrew support. What is the reason for this?
I think one needs to look at the larger picture. The larger picture is that the UPA as a political entity, particularly its leader, the Congress, is losing credibility and support across the country due to various factors. I mean, the spate of corruption scandals is one reason. The uncontrolled price rise and inflation is another reason. And this is a trend that has, you know, gathered momentum over the last 2 years or so. So allies who are with these parties, they know that, you know, that it doesn't benefit for them to stay with the Congress when the next elections take place. So I think, you know, you will see this trend. I mean, it started with Trinamool Congress.
Right.
It has now come to Dravida Munnetra Kazhagam. I think, as you mentioned, it will also start reflecting in the maneuvers of the NCP. Whether they will actually leave or not is a different question. But in there will be a kind of, you know.
So you know this general understanding or general wisdom that the DMK has done this for the sake of the local, the state level, it is a state level politics which they are playing. This has nothing to do with the larger issues, that it is there, you know, the ADMK versus DMK.
This is essentially consolidation of the constituency.
Yes.
On an emotive issue.
Yes.
And perhaps the DMK could not have got a better issue than this to walk out of the UP and blame the government. So I think the timing is good for the DMK, but whether it will actually be able to capitalize politically is another matter.
So, you know, you are also presuming that there is no going back.
Absolutely not.
You don't think right now there's a meeting being held. You know, the speaker has called an all-party meeting about these things. Karunanidhi, during his interaction yesterday, you know, gave some room for maneuvering. He said that if the Parliament comes out with a resolution as he demands, you know, there can be a rethink.
But I don't think that the resolution is going to come up in the way the DMK wants it, because that kind of compromise the Congress cannot make, because it will have larger impact
implications.
So I don't think the Congress can succumb to that demand, and DMK perhaps also knows that very well, that, you know, Congress cannot succumb to that demand. I think that this is the end of the road for the DMK-UPA partnership.
That's interesting. Nilotpal, though you don't have any role to play in this, and you know, you people were in the same position in 2008. You know, what is it that creates this kind of problems in this coalition?
I think our approach to the first UPA government was a little different. When we decided to support the UPA government so that there could be a secular dispensation at the center, because that was in the backdrop of 6 years of NDA and the disastrous communal genocide in Gujarat, our foremost concern was to have a secular government installed at the center. in spite of the fact that 90% of our MPs had defeated both the Congress and the BJP.
Right.
But we insisted that there should be a common minimum program adopted by the UPA and which should be acceptable to us. Therefore, you see, the vital difference that we see between the UPA 1 government and the UPA 2 is that neither there is a left which is which was doggedly acting as a watchdog to ensure the implementation of the common minimum program in the interest of the people, nor do you have a common minimum program at all. And you have the monstrous situation where 29% votes for the Congress has led to a situation where instead of being fulcrum of a coalition, Congress has become unilateral in running the country, the economy, the politics and so on and so forth. So there is a inbuilt contradiction between the interest of the people and the manner in which the government functions. And it is the stress of that conflict of interest which gets manifested in many ways.
Okay,
but I am not so sure as Venkitesh about DMK sticking to this withdrawal decision, nor I am very clear about the final outcome. But meanwhile, the other issue has come up that Beni Prasad Varma comments and
yes.
Samajwadi Party's response. So in any way, the situation is quite hazy and uncertain, and this does not augur well for the country apart from the government itself.
Nilotpal, you made one interesting point. You said during the UPA one, you know, this was a secular agenda which brought this government in and you people supported them. You know, do you think, you know, the Congress had 145 seats in UPA 1, now it has 205 seats. Is this increase in the seats which has created this kind of an attitude of the Congress, which you say, you know, has become unilateral and it is not, it doesn't take the allies along, as you think there is a marked difference in the way it's in its approach towards its allies in UPA 1 and UPA 2?
Possibly that is the first factor, because you see, in a fast-past-the-post system, sometimes enhancement of the number of seats may make you unmindful of the actual ground reality. Between 2004 and 2009 election, Congress vote share increase was a little less than 1%. So on the ground, nothing had moved, but a disproportionate increase in the number of seats had blunted their political instinct, and they thought not having a CMP would be helpful. But at the same time, it denied the Congress to have that cementing instrument which could also tie down its allies. And the second problem is this, that after having dislodged the left, because the left has a certain policy and ideological perception with which we engaged during the UPA. So many of the things which actually led to Congress and UPA 2's formation were result of the engagement between the left, though it may appear paradoxical, as a result of the engagement between the left and the Congress and the UPA as a whole, like this REGA, like the Right to Information Bill, forest land rights, and so on and so forth.
Okay.
So I think that this parting ways with the left has actually, in political terms, harmed the Congress more than the immediate setback which people may have thought was being suffered by the
okay.
left.
Okay. Venkitesh, you know, this is a running theme of the left party, that, you know, when we were there, the government was better and things like that. And I think by and large, many people also agree with that. But tell me that, you know, when the UPA 2 was formed, why didn't a party like the DMK, with its experience in the previous 5-year term, why did it not insist on a common minimum program? Why did it not insist on, you know, some of these issues which were bound to come up during the course of these 5 years? Why did it be satisfied without a common minimum program?
If you remember the early days of the UPA 2, was itself marked by a kind of crisis.
Right.
The A Raja appointment, the breaking of the 2G spectrum scam.
Yes.
So neither the DMK nor the other allies, I mean, in fact, I think there are many other allies which could have done with the common minimum program.
Right. Like
Trinamool Congress at that point of time could have done with the common minimum program. NCP could have done with the common minimum program. But all these parties were not able to push for anything because of the larger crisis that had engulfed the government right at the beginning of its innings.
And there were problems, you know, DMK did not first come into the government, and there was a lack of confidence in the DMK itself.
There was a lack of confidence in DMK, and there was a lack of confidence in the Congress also, whether this will break in the beginning itself. There was a doubt. So I think all these factors ultimately, went in favor of the Congress within the coalition. And I think that is how the common minimum program did not come, and that is how the UPA 2 decisively does not have the kind of direction that the UPA 1 had. So this larger picture is there. I mean, I think this continuation of this lack of direction, this drift, has been a central characteristic of the UPA 2.
And you think that, you know, it is this, you know, this has been the Sri Lankan crisis, the Sri Lankan situation is being used by the DMK just as an excuse to get out of what you think, they think is...
It's not a politically beneficial relationship
anymore.
Yeah.
Okay. On that note, I think we will go into a short break now. We will come back and continue this discussion. Please keep watching. Welcome back. We are discussing the crisis faced by the UPA government and asking the question, will it be able to survive this crisis? We are now joined in by J.D. Seelam, the Congress MP. Welcome. Seelam, you know, before you came in, the two other guests on my show are, you know, feel that the crisis which has been created now is of the making of the Congress, which leads the coalition. What is your opinion?
Girish, I don't know what has happened and who are the guests.
I have Nilotpal, Basu, and
opposition member. I know, rightly so.
Yes.
What generally it is made out is, whatever happens in this country, the good, they don't give credit to the Congress party. Somewhere something happens, they attribute that this is because of Congress party. This is unfair. I think let us go by the merits of the issue under discussion.
Right.
So what is the discussion now? Is the DMK right in withdrawing? So what are the consequences? That's what I presumably, you know.
Will the question which I'm asking is, will the UPA government be able to survive this crisis?
Yeah, I think basically, nobody is now, willing to go for polls. The government is having numbers, and government has certain, you know, agenda which is very dear to Nilotpal Basuji and to the people of this country. The people want the food security bill, the women reservation, the Lokpal bill. Those legislations are very important. I think the government would like to finish the agenda which they have set in the interest of the common man in this country. That is, I think that makes the government continue its work.
So,
and of course, there is a reservation bill for promotion of SCST, etc., which we are trying to, pass it through.
Seelam,
trying to take everybody on board.
Seelam, yeah. Seelam, you know, it's very well that, you know, you're warning the other allies, the other parties in the parliament that, look, you know, we have to do all these things. So give, but you know, what is? Do you think that DMK has taken this step? The step which it has taken now, do you think it will be able to come back? Do you think they will be able to come back with certain assurances? Or do you think this is the end of the Congress-DMK relationship?
There is nothing permanent in DMK relations with any national party like Congress. I think they are right. They wanted to express their anguish. They have a very right to do so. But I am sure in the interest of the nation, they will support the legislations which they think is in the interest of the common man. I am very hopeful. I think let us see how it goes, because we are keeping those options open. Our people are working. I am sure that will be a positive outcome.
But Seelam, it's very interesting that some of the legislations which you spoke about are all social legislations. But you know, you didn't say anything about the economic reforms.
No, I think those reforms will continue to take precedence, because you cannot go back on certain reforms looking at the, you know, way the finance minister has explained the predicament in which our country is placed now. Not only that, you know, you can't isolate India from the rest of the communities.
So,
but I would suggest, while it doesn't mean that the government is only pursuing economic reforms, but economic reforms are necessary to galvanize the resources to pump in into social sectors.
Okay.
These are linked. It is not that
they are
separate and these reforms
Absolutely.
Are separate.
They are linked, but you know how far the government will be able to push those reforms. Anyway, we'll keep that aside for a moment. Let me come to Nilotpal. Nilotpal, let's look at this issue itself, the Sri Lankan issue. Do you think that the demand being made by the DMK, you know, is a valid demand? Is it something which the Indian Parliament can do, can come out with a resolution as they are demanding? What are the implications if the Parliament comes out with that kind of a resolution?
I mean, I'm responding to that, but before that, I must compliment my good friend Mr. Seelam, because he has the heart in the right place.
Yes.
And the way he just sequenced his priorities and all that, it is very clear that he is complimenting us in the left about some of these social legislations. Now, so far as the Tamil issue, Sri Lankan issue is concerned, you see, it's a complex issue. First of all, we have to recognize that, because in the dying stages of the military operations there against LTTE, which almost assumed the proportion of a civil war, there is no doubt that there were blatant violations of human rights,
right,
and for which there must be justice. And I think in Sri Lanka itself, they have recognized this by constituting this commission, Truth and Lessons Learned Commission, and which has actually come out with a very excellent recommendations. The unfortunate part is that Sri Lankan government is not implementing some of these recommendations. Therefore, our approach should be to try and see that the Sri Lankan government agrees on the platform of the UN to implement these recommendations. The extraneous resolution business is quite dangerous, given the overall foreign policy orientation of United States and some of the Western allies. We are seeing that human rights is become a major foreign policy stick,
right,
for American seeking hegemony,
right,
in the contemporary world. You see, I was reading excellent articles about this 10th anniversary of one decade of invasion of Iraq. I mean, it is as clear as daylight what is happening in West Asia.
So India must
be wary of outside intervention in Sri Lanka to enforce something. But at the same time, we must forcefully.
Nilotpal, so what you are trying to say is, if India supports any kind of resolution where the Sri Lankans are forced to, you know, outside intervention in Sri Lanka, then the same thing can happen to us. Is that what you're trying to say?
There are soft spots as far as India is concerned. That of course is there, but more than that, you see, even to seek justice for the victims of human rights violations, I think the problem is that Sri Lankans themselves also And the Sri Lankan government also realizes that there have been violations.
Yes.
And they have come to this conclusion. So I think we will be in a stronger ground to force the Sri Lankan government to say that you don't accept our proposals, but whatever your own commission, which you yourself officially constituted, you implement them. I mean, there is no political alibi or excuse which can be offered by the Sri Lankan government not to do that.
So
instead of sounding, you see, jingoistic, that should be the approach. And I think on that, we can really create that kind of a diplomatic pressure within the UN on the Sri Lankan government to move. Because we are seeing on the other question of autonomy for the Tamil-speaking regions also, President Rajapakse is reneging on his earlier comment that they will go beyond Article 13 in their constitution to devolve political powers.
I think Seelam wants to. Yes, Seelam, you wanted to react to that.
Yeah, I agree with Nilotpal ji. I was one of the members of the all-party delegation which went to Sri Lanka. We spent quite a bit of time, 5 days in Sri Lanka. All-party delegation had discussions with the President of Sri Lanka and the External Affairs Minister and other senior ministerial colleagues. We visited Jaffna, the northern parts, and then eastern parts. We met the people who suffered a lot of damages. There is a rehabilitation, reconciliation. That LLRC, Nilotpal ji is mentioning, the Lessons Learned and Reconciliation Commission, those recommendations are excellent. He is right. They should implement their own commission's recommendations. And so, President Rajapaksa assured us, we made our sincere efforts. I think the ball lies in Sri Lanka's court. They have to, and the government should use all our, as he said, the foreign policy has to reflect the collective will of all the political parties. Twice we had discussion in Rajya Sabha, and there is a consensus.
Seelam,
there is a consensus. So I think we have to go about with that. Yes.
So yes. Seelam, why do you think the DMK has raised this issue? Are they only reacting to what is happening in the ground in Tamil Nadu? The kind of emotional surcharge and atmosphere which we are seeing in some parts of Tamil Nadu, or you think that they are using it as an excuse to get out of the UPA?
No, I think they have a real concern. Not only DMK, the Tamil political parties, Congress, the Tamil leaders of Congress party and the AIDMK also. When the topic was there in Rajya Sabha, they all reacted and then explained what is the ground reality in Tamil Nadu. The students are, when students come to the roads, all the political parties will become irrelevant. So they should, they are only reflecting
their
aspirations.
Okay.
And of course, we are trying to tell them. They are reflecting. They have their concerns. And we must also understand considering its foreign policy imperatives, but yeah.
Seelam, but will you admit that your government has not been able to convince that its ally in Tamil Nadu with about all these things, and that's why this break has happened? It is the failure of the government to convince
that the government is doing. I don't think it's a failure of the government. They have been trying to convince. Look, Girish, it's easy to say it has failed. No, it's a process. It cannot be an event. Look at the way we have traveled. So government has been, trying its best to tell them, look, we are doing our best. There are certain things.
Let
I
us
think
see.
The DMK could have waited a little bit, but I don't blame them. This is a whole. It's unfortunate that this has happened. We will try to sort it out. I'm very optimistic.
Venkitesh, this uprising or this emotional scenes which we are witnessing in Tamil, was it a creation of the political parties or it was a very spontaneous reaction from the ground?
I think it's a spontaneous reaction from the ground, because if you look at the history of the impact of the Seelam issue in Tamil Nadu over the years. I think since 1991, after the assassination of Rajiv Gandhi, the Seelam issue has not been able to pick up the kind of momentum in spite of the effort of people like Vaiko. But then this time, I think it is genuine, especially because of the genocide, the way...
But the genocide happened 2 years back. And that point of time, the DMK was not, DMK did not take as hard a stand as it is taking today. Why? How will they explain that?
That is where the role of the media comes in. I think the way Velupilli Prabhakaran's son's murder...
That has revived the...
That has changed. That has given a new emotive character.
Those photographs. Yes.
So I think, you know, it is in that context that DMK has seen this opportunity. And because it has not been able to play the role of a good opposition in the state.
In Tamil Nadu.
So that is also a factor. So in the overall context, the DMK feels that this is a good time to, you know, work on this jingoism, this Tamil nationalism. And there are fears that in among the observers of Tamil Nadu politics that this could even lead to a competitive jingoism between the DMK
and the ADMK.
And it would have disastrous results. And even there, perhaps one would see the Congress, you know, incapable of handling the situation.
Okay, and so last words, very quickly, UPA will survive this crisis?
Absolutely. Again, as Seelam and Nilotpal also suggested, I don't think any party wants elections at this point of time. And even on the question of reforms, I think willy-nilly the government will be able to push through its reforms. If you look at what happened in the FDI, the Samajwadi Party and Bahujan Samaj Party made, you know, very big noises opposing it outside, but finally when it came...
So the departure of DMK is an opportunity for the Congress Party to push some of its program. Will you look at it?
Not necessarily, but it will have some hiccups, it will have some problems, but then ultimately I think the direction of the government will continue as it is.
Okay. On that note, I think we'll have to end. The UPA government is in a crisis, no doubt. But surviving this crisis, it may survive, or rather everybody thinks that it will survive this crisis, but it may lead to a further crisis. We'll keep a close watch and see how it will all pan out in the coming days. Thanks to all my guests, Nilotpal Basu, J.D. Seelam, Venkitesh, Ramakrishnan. Please keep watching. We'll come back with another issue on the Big Picture same time tomorrow.